So yeah, so I should mention that, you know, I tend to put a lot of information on my slides and talk quickly, but these slides are already available on my webpage. And if you go there, you'll see that this is quite possibly the longest title I've used for a talk ever. But so as both Kevin and Rob have emphasized, there are really two things we could be talking about here, right? There's one task where you try to teach students how to use a proof assistant. It's another thing entirely to use a proof assistant to teach students to do mathematics. And I think that that second task is a lot harder. So there is, Rob, I think that's your microphone. So the second task is a lot harder because proof assistants are hard to use. And if you're not careful, you know, all the time can go into, you know, getting students to learn the syntax of the system are really distracting from the mathematics. I think there are good reasons to do that. So, you know, I've run through, you know, a number of them here that, you know, when you're using a proof assistant, you get immediate feedback as to, you know, whether you're doing the right thing. And as Rob mentioned, you get the context at any point in your proof. You know exactly what objects are available to you, what assumptions you've made, what you're trying to do. You know, we expect that the formalism, you know, helps clarify the logical structure of informal mathematics. So, you know, when you teach the skills together, you know, writing informal proofs and writing formal proofs, then the two should reinforce each other. We also think that the technology, you know, for students who are going to go into mathematics, we expect the technology will play an increasing role in mathematics. Certainly in computer science, you know, there's a growing industry out there in formal verification and using proof assistants in particular for verifying hardware and software. And finally, formalization is enjoyable in its own right. And one reason to sort of make a big deal about this is to emphasize that, in fact, this is not what this talk is about. So this is not what I'm doing. Most of the talks in this meeting, I gather, are about using proof assistants to teach students to do mathematics. Whereas explicitly what I'm going to talk about is teaching students to use proof assistants. So students who already know some mathematics. So I want to say just from the start, you know, hats off to Rob, Giha, and Paolo, you know, everybody in the conference who are doing the brave, you know, the more difficult thing. I think Kevin, and if I understand, you know, Philip's abstract correctly, and I were all addressing a much easier audience, which is that students who already, you know how to read and write mathematical proofs and are specifically, you know, in our classroom to learn how to use a proof assistant. And I'll try to convince you that this is also, you know, an important and useful thing to do. So what I will talk about is a course I taught last semester in the fall at Carnegie Mellon called Interactive Theorem Proving. The abstract is listed there. Maybe I'll read through it quickly. So computational proof assistants now make it possible to work interactively, to write mechanically verified definitions, theorems, and proofs. Important theorems have been formalized in this way. Digital libraries are being developed collaboratively by the mathematical community. Formalization of mathematics also serves as a gateway to the use of new technologies for discovery, such as automated reasoning and machine learning. This course will teach you how to formalize mathematics so that you too can contribute to the effort, and so on. But I want to call attention to some features of the abstract. So first of all, the number 21321. So 21 signifies that it's a course in the math department, which at Carnegie Mellon is called the Department of Mathematical Sciences. The 300 level indicates that it's intended as a third year course, so for the third year of a 4-year undergraduate curriculum. Students can take it at any time, but that kind of signals, you know, what the level of difficulty and maturity is that's expected. 3 50-minute lectures is pretty standard. It was Monday, Wednesday, Friday. 9 units is also pretty standard. So students have to take, on the average, 45 units a semester to graduate. So this will typically be one of, you know, 5 or more courses that they take at the same time. The number 9 units also suggests that, you know, it should be about 9 hours of their time each week. So in addition to the 3 hours of lecture, you know, you can expect them to spend another 6 hours roughly, you know, working on homework and learning the material and so on. And finally, the prerequisites are the introduction to mathematics courses in computer science and the math department. So that's listed on these slides. So this just repeats what I just said. But so the two prerequisites are 21, 128, mathematical concepts and proof, and 15151 Mathematical Foundations for Computer Science. So they're both Introduction to Mathematical Proof. The 12 units indicates that's a little bit more than a 9-unit course, so it's a little bit more effort. And they're supposed to be substantial, solid, introduction to proofs. And they're required for mathematics and computer science majors, respectively. So in the course, Wojtek Nowowski is a third-year PhD student with me. He was my teaching assistant, and he was absolutely wonderful. So I don't know what I would have done without him. The goal of the course was simply to teach students how to formalize mathematics as quickly as possible. I had 22 students, 13 from math, 6 from computer science, 2 from electrical computer engineering, 1 from chemical engineering, so roughly 13 mathematics and 9 engineering. The demographics, so in terms of the year maturity, 1 freshman, 4 sophomores, 6 juniors, 7 seniors, 3 masters and a PhD student. It hit the right target. PhD students, C students were welcome to take the class. I only had one, but would have been happy to have had more. In terms of the demographics were not great. Formal methods, we have this challenge. So in the class, there were only 2 women, 1 transgender student, and only 1 student, I think, who could be considered part of an underrepresented community in any sense. So those numbers are disappointing. Those were the demographics. And students were graded basically on assignments, sort of weekly assignments, and then 2 projects. So 1 at the middle of the semester and 1 at the end. And I'll say more about them. It's important that there were. Well, it's interesting. Yeah, most classes at Carnegie Mellon do have exams. I just chose not to give exams. I tried to arrange that rather that just students have just a steady, steady amount of work throughout the semester, and kind of keep it predictable. There's some stress around the fact that, with a 2-week or a 3-week project at the end, that students need to have the discipline to plan and spend time on it. Despite the fact they have 3 problem sets due the next day. But otherwise, I tried to keep it low stress. As far as the motivations, coming back to the previous list, some of them carry over. Even for students in mathematics, the idea is if you're formalizing a piece of mathematics, that's a good way to really understand the mathematics better. As Kevin points out, students think they understand something and then they sit down to formalize it and realize, we often think we understand something and then sit down to formalize it and understand that we don't. As before, formal technology may be useful for students going on in mathematics, certainly for students going on in computer science. But finally, I want to emphasize this last point, that formalization is enjoyable in its own way. I think this was really important to me as well. Many of us, look back on our college years fondly as, some of the best years of our lives, because we had the opportunity to just learn things that we enjoyed learning. And I worry that students today are getting less of that. There's more competition. There's more the feeling that you have to take certain courses to get ahead and do the things you have to do. So I think it's important to give students an experience that is meaningful to them and something that they enjoy. So that was one of the goals in the course as well. So for the first half of the course, we used Mathematics and Lean. Let's see if I can click to get it up. So this is a textbook. It's still a work in progress, but Rob, Patrick, Kevin, and I have been working on it. The textbook was written with a course like this in mind. The goal is to teach students to formalize mathematics as quickly as possible. So, you work through basics and logical connectives and how to prove things with negation and quantifiers, and sets and functions and a little bit of number theory and algebraic structures. And the idea is, the first 6 chapters are really just kind of the core stuff. It's basically how to formalize, how to use a proof assistant, all the basic stuff you need to know. And then after that, we can include then more topics in different areas that, are more specific to things that students might be interested in. So that was the first half of the course. After that, I did spend about a week, a couple of lectures telling them about the logical foundations. Once they had been using the formalism, for a number of weeks, I thought it'd be good to step back and say, here's what a type is, here what dependent types are, here are the axioms, here are the rules. So I gave them an overview of that. And then towards the end of the course, while students were working on projects, we really kind of focused on topics that came up in that context. So the lectures, you know, I lectured using a laptop and projecting on a screen. So this was, you know, something that we learned to do during the pandemic. And, you know, for teaching formalization, it actually works pretty well. You know, one drawback is that, you know, with blackboards, you can kind of space out and then kind of come back and then look three blackboards behind and, you know, see what you missed. And, you know, you have sort of a broader look at the scope of the lecture. At the end of the course in a questionnaire, one student suggested that it might have been. So what I would do is I would prepare a lecture with kind of, you know, I would prepare a lean file with kind of sorries, you know, stuff taken out. And then I would do some kind of live proofing during the class, but they had the file. And students pointed out that it would have been helpful for them to have the file before class so they could follow along on their laptops. Also this year, you know, because of COVID, I streamed the lectures on Zoom because it wasn't much more effort to do that. I just had to start Zoom at the beginning. And so, you know, if students were out sick, they could watch. And then as long as you're streaming on Zoom, well, you may as well hit the record button as well. So they went online and students could, you know, watch it at their leisure. But I'll probably dispense with that in the future because it really, I was given that, I'm surprised that as many students showed up in person as did. But I'd really rather not discourage them from coming in person because I think that the experience is better that way. So here's a quick, you know, overview. I sort of went back to the lectures because now I have, you know, I have all the lectures as lean files, so I could look back and see what we did from week to week. So these are, you know, the American dates. So this is, I mean, this is August, September, you know, October. And so it was a 14 week semester with like a week of fall break in the middle. Again, this is all in the talk that you can find online, but roughly the idea is the first half of the semester, we spent just working through mathematics and lean. So, the first week was just introduction, getting set up and so on, but then just starting in the basics and on chapter two, then logic and connectives and so on, chapter three. And then as we went, they started to show them a little bit of the automation they could use. Linearith came in pretty quickly, but the simplifier, but then sets, functions, relations, and so on. And right before fall break, you know, we showed them how to define algebraic structures, what instance meant. They'd been using algebraic structures all along on homeworks and so on, but we sort of explained lean's mechanisms for doing algebra. And so the idea was, at this point, they really knew the basics. They knew how to formalize mathematics. They had everything they need to go through the library, find things. Right before fall break, I told them that after fall break, they would have to do their first project, a two-week project. I'll come back to talk about the projects later. So that way they could think about it over fall break. So after the fall break, while they're working on the project, I told them a little bit about the logic and the foundations and miscellaneous topics. Like, for example, I had never told them how to use, you know, if-then expressions and how to prove things and split, you know, on cases and so on. Style guidelines for writing, you know, not just writing any proofs, but writing nice-looking proofs. In the seventh week, in the 11th week, Heather McBeth came to visit and gave two guest lectures, which were absolutely wonderful. So it was a pleasure having you there. But then, you know, just extra topics, quotients, finite sums and products, you know, little things that come up, a little bit of discrete math. And then at this point, you know, after the first project, Wojtek and I could go through the projects and see what they had trouble with and see what they were trying to do and, you know, try to fill in their sorries or shorten their proofs. And then I spent, you know, a couple of weeks going over those. The idea is giving them feedback on things that they had done in the hopes that these topics would be of interest to others. So really the last few weeks of the class were just kind of a grab bag of topics. Just trying to give them information they need to work on the projects they were working on. Students had to learn GitHub. We put files and assignments in two ways. So the assignments and the lectures, the lean found from lectures, were put in a course repository that they could just pull regularly to get the updated materials. So as we went, we kept adding material and they kept pulling. But then also to do the homework, we gave students each instruction. Each student had to set up their own GitHub repository, share a private one, share it with us. And they used that for their homework. So they would, you know, we would tell them where to put it in their repository. But they would do the homework, leave it in the repository. We would pull it. We could look over it. Wojtek would grade it, give them comments and push it back, and so on. So they you know, they got used to that workflow. And there were no problems with that. And the projects, so the projects were really entirely open-ended. I just said, you know, formalize it, do anything you want. Just, you know, work-wise, it should be, you know, the same, roughly the same. You should be doing the same amount of work you were doing when you were working on the weekly assignments. Just formalize something interesting. I told students that if they wanted to, they could do joint projects. They chose not to. I mean, they were very social. They did hang out and formalize together, but for the most part, they did individual assignments. Because of, you know, their background at Carnegie Mellon, there's a lot of discrete math and analysis that came up. And also toward the end of the semester, rather than lecture three times a week, we dropped down to two lectures a week. And then we had sort of expanded hours where students could just come by and work on their assignments, you know, and get, and, you know, Wojtek and I were on hand to answer questions and help them out. And so, you know, there were things like, you know, as you would expect, you know, proofs about Fibonacci numbers and elementary number theory and binomial coefficients. Interestingly, you know, I mean, combinatorics is big at Carnegie Mellon. Two students tried to prove the Lovash local lemma, which is a theorem that has lots of application in extremal graph theory. And one student actually pulled it off. As a mid-semester project, one student just looked up the proof of the Bolzano Weierstrass theorem on Wikipedia and then formalized it. Towards the end of the week, you know, in this conference, I think Connor will talk about his work and formalizing set theory. He did. I mean, so Connor and Zachar, I think, are both going to speak, and I can brag on their behalf. So Connor, I think the final project was to show that if kappas and uncountable regular cardinal, then the intersection of less than kappa many closed unbounded sets is again closed and unbounded. There were a number of computer science students in the class. One student did something with separation logic. And then Zach, who's speaking at the end of the week, formalized simply typed lambda calculus. So mid-semester, he proved progress in type preservation. And final project, he proved a normalization theorem, which is quite impressive. I told students that a good strategy is always to, you know, you can just pick a homework problem from another class and formalize that. So I think this was a mid-semester project. So let kappa be a compact metric space, suppose the set of functions. Fi is uniformly equicontinuous, and Fi converges to F pointwise, prove that Fi converges to F uniformly. I mean, this really was a homework assignment that you know, for this other class, and the student just formalized it. Felix Feilacher, the one PhD student in the class, did some really impressive things that are now in MathLib. So there's the Cantor-Bendixson theorem, which says that if you have a closed set in a separable metric space or a Polish space, you can throw countably many points away and get a perfect set. And this is the a descriptive set theoretic version of the Schroeder-Bernstein theorem. So if you have measurable embeddings back and forth, then there's a measurable bijection between them. And similarly, if you have Borel, and as a corollary of that, you get if there are Borel injections back and forth, then the two spaces are Borel isomorphic. A lot of students at Carnegie Mellon like to take the Putnam exam. So there are a lot of people like formalizing, you know, math competition-like problems. This first one was a mid-semester project. So if F composed with F composed with F, if F is continuous and F composed with F composed with F is the identity function, then F is the identity function. And these, I think one student did these two, formalized, proved these two formally as a final project. And here's another example so if you have F is a continuous function that satisfies F of X plus Y is equal to F of X times F of Y, then if F is non-zero, then it has to be an exponential function. It's good, honest work. I mean, you prove this for the natural numbers, then the integers, then the rationals, and then you use density to extend it. And, you know, they figured it out. So by then they were using the library and, you know, they had all the skills worked out. So other information. So students were encouraged to introduce themselves on Zulip and, you know, ask questions, and many of them did. And so finally, just the overall reception. I see I'm doing pretty well on time. So students like the course. So in the US, it's common. Your students are expected at the end of the semester, they're asked to evaluate the courses and the information is made available to future students. So, you know, and faculty. So we know what they thought of the course. So of the 22 students, 14 responded, you know, filled out their questionnaires, which I think is pretty typical. And if you're looking, so, you know, they have a list of questions that they get to answer and rank the course on a scale from 1 to 5. And so the red is this course. The blue is average for the math department. Yellow is average for the college, and green is average for the university. And so you see that, and so overall, there's the overall teaching and overall course at the end. So you see that the students liked the course. This is pretty striking, but you know, keep in mind that when you look at, for example, the mathematics department averages, you know, this includes all the introductory, you know, calculus classes for students in the natural sciences and linear algebra for business majors. These are all, you know, the service courses. So I think, you know, what this says is that, you know, students really appreciate these elective courses that they can take, you know, and just have fun with. I also asked students to fill out a Google poll to get a little bit more information. Only about 9 of them did, but here are 3 of the questions I asked. It was short. So I asked, you know, about the pace of the class, and almost everybody said, of the 9 students, you know, 7 said it was just right, 1 said a little too fast, one said a little bit too slow. This was more interesting, of the weekly assignments. A number of said about right, a couple said they were a little bit difficult, more said that they were easier. They were, and in the beginning, Wojtek and I, we just didn't know what to expect. You know, again, syntax and learning a new language is hard. So, you know, we were a little bit careful. But you know, it's notable when students tell you that the homework was too easy. So I think this, you know, like Rob, I think we kind of undershot just a little bit. And so I think, you know, next time we can let ourselves, you know, challenge them a little bit more. The projects were difficulty was about right. Some said a little bit difficult. And then one student wrote in an answer, which was basically saying that, well, you know, look, you told us we could do whatever we want for the final project or for the projects. So so of course it was about right, because, you know, he said we could do what we wanted. That went well. The students, you know, optionally could write in comments, and you know, they were generally quite good. These are, you know, these are some of the best. So one said, thanks so much for this course. I had a really great time and will be quick to recommend it. It's been such a consistent thing to look forward to every week. It got me excited for the future of this field in mathematics. One of the coolest courses I've taken at CMU so far. Or I like this one, great course, make it a requirement for the math major rather than just an elective in the future. You know, I'm fine with that. Let me just read you one last quotation that I really liked, because it really spoke to, you know, the reasons that we taught the course. So this student wrote a lot. The student wrote that, despite taking this course as a last minute decision during scheduling last year, it quickly became one of my favorite math courses I've taken to date. The material is very approachable and honestly just fun. Lean is a very enjoyable theorem prover to work with, and few things are as satisfying as that goals complete at the end of a long proof. The homeworks were always reasonable difficulty and never took too long to complete. And the open-ended projects allowed me to investigate a particular area of interest and really reinforce that area through formalization. All in all, this is a fantastic class. And for other students' sake, I hope it gets offered again soon. So that was really, really nice to hear. So, I mean, anything, you know, I might say after that is going to be a little bit anticlimactic. But just to sum up, you know, that... I think teaching students to formalize mathematics is fine. I mean, teaching the course was work. It was a fair amount of work, but it was a lot of fun and very rewarding. You know, having formal skills, I mean, being able to use a proof assistant or just formal syntax, you know, more broadly is, you know, maybe useful for students going on in mathematics or computer science. In any case, it doesn't seem to have hurt them much. And you know, most importantly, they really seem to enjoy the experience. So if you are thinking about teaching such a course, my advice to you is is just do it. So thank you very much.